Good afternoon. Good afternoon. I'm Eugene Meyer. Welcome to our sixth annual Rosenkranz debate. And I want to express our gratitude to the Rosenkranz Foundation for supporting this event. We love having this Saturday debate as a centerpiece for our convention, an intellectually sharp one-on-one debate between two highly prominent legal theorists. This series had a wonderful start in 2008 with a discussion between judges Richard Posner and Mike McConnell. In 2009, we featured judges Guido Calabresi and Frank Easterbrook. In 2010, Professors Richard Epstein and William Eskridge. In 2011, Paul Clement and Larry Tribe debated healthcare. In 2012, Judge Kaczynski and Hadley Arkes debated. And last year, it featured Professor Randy Barnett and Judge J. Harvey Wilkinson. To moderate this year's debate, I want to introduce Professor Nick Quinn Rosenkranz, who has helped make these debates possible. He is, among other things, a professor at Georgetown of Law at Georgetown Law School, author of groundbreaking articles on constitutional interpretation, and co-chairman of our Board of Visitors. Professor Rosenkranz.
Thanks very much. It's a pleasure to be here. We're very excited about this debate. You've been here for a couple of days, and our panels are very rich, very nuanced. You often end up hearing four different overlapping perspectives. But we thought by Saturday what you'd be ready for is a real sharp difference of opinion. So this is a one-on-one debate that we've done for several years and we're particularly excited about. This one, I'm going to just briefly introduce our debaters. The accomplishments of these two are incredibly impressive, but in the interest of time, I'm not going to run through them all. You have access to their full bios in your programs and I think on your apps and so forth. So I'm just going to be brief about that. So arguing for the motion is Professor Nadine Strossen. She's currently a professor at New York Law School. She served as president of the ACLU for 18 years, from 1991 to 2008. And it's safe to say she is one of the great champions of civil liberties of our time. And you know, I just want to note that Nadine is a great and valued friend to the Federalist Society. She comes here and she knows that her positions will not always be popular with us. But she comes anyway, year after year, and she comes in exactly the right spirit, which is in the hopes of persuading us. She comes in hopes of persuading us and with an open mind about perhaps being persuaded herself, and this is exactly the ethos of the Federalist Society, and it's exactly the ethos of our debate, so we're very grateful to her. It's a pleasure to have you here. It's an honor to be on stage with you today. All right, arguing against the motion is the Honorable Michael Mukasey. He is currently a partner at Debevoise in Plimpton from 1988 to 2006. He served as a district judge in the U.S. District Court for the Southern District of New York, and for the last several of those years as its chief judge. While on the bench, he presided over numerous cases, including, most relevant for our purposes, major terrorism cases, including the trial of Jose Padilla and Omar Abdel Rahmed and the blind Sheikh. From 2007 to 2009, he served as the 81st Attorney General of the United States, grappling with some of the thorniest legal issues concerning the war on terror. And we should say Judge Mukasey, too, is a great and valued friend to the Federalist Society, and he actually serves on our board of directors. So we're delighted to have you here. It's an honor to be on stage with you as well, Judge. I'll just briefly explain our format to you. So we're going to begin with opening statements of 12 minutes each. Then we're going to have replies or rebuttals of 7 minutes each. Then we'll have a less formal, less structured give and take, perhaps if necessary, spurred on by your humble moderator. And then, time permitting, we'll take questions from the audience. Okay, so finally, before we begin, I'm just going to give you the relevant text of our debate here today. First, the text of the Fourth Amendment to the United States Constitution, quote, "The right of the people to be secure in their persons, houses, papers, and effects against unreasonable searches and seizures shall not be violated, and no warrants shall issue but upon probable cause, supported by oath or affirmation, and particularly describing the place to be searched and the persons or things to be seized." That's the Fourth Amendment, and again, our resolution here today, resolved, quote, "Indiscriminate collection of American phone records violates the Fourth Amendment." Nadine is arguing for the motion. She's arguing, in other words, that such collection of phone records does violate the Fourth Amendment. We begin with her opening statement. Nadine.
I'm delighted to once again speak at this convention, and I would like to thank the Federalist Society again, as I've been glad to do on some of your promotional materials, for spurring discussion of constitutional law and civil liberties issues. Not to mention what many consider to be your greatest achievement, namely spurring the founding of the American Constitution Society. My favorite aspect of the Federalist Society is your very first founding principle, which could have come straight from the ACLU policy guide, that the state exists to preserve freedom. That core principle of your mission statement strongly supports today's proposition that indiscriminate collection of American phone records violates the Fourth Amendment. That proposition is also supported by two approaches to constitutional interpretation that are favored by the many conservatives in the Federalist Society: the Constitution's text and its original understanding, including by your patron saint, James Madison, whose profile graces your tie. Now, As a civil libertarian, I, of course, also revere Madison. So many years ago, I bought one of your ties for my husband, and I told him that all of those FSs stand for free speech. The founders in general, and Madison in particular, were stressed by Judge Richard Leon last year when he granted a preliminary injunction against the NSA's dragnet phone records collection on Fourth Amendment grounds. Notably, Judge Leon is a respected conservative. As he said, "I cannot imagine a more indiscriminate and arbitrary invasion than this high-tech collection and retention of personal data on virtually every single citizen without prior judicial approval. Surely such a program infringes on the privacy that the founders enshrined in the Fourth Amendment. Indeed," he concluded, "I have little doubt that the author of our Constitution, James Madison, would be aghast." The Fourth Amendment imposes two essential constraints on government's power to invade our privacy and liberty. One substantive, one procedural, and both are violated by the indiscriminate phone collection program. So substantively, the government may not subject you to a search or seizure without probable cause to believe that you are acting illegally. Procedurally, the government may not conduct a search or seizure unless an independent judge has concluded that it does indeed have probable cause, individualized suspicion. So the Fourth Amendment expressly bars the type of dragnet phone records program that the NSA has been conducting without any individualized probable cause warrants. To the contrary, this program proceeds under blanket FISA court warrants that purport to authorize wholesale, suspicionless collection of all of our records. This is the very kind of hated general warrant and general search that spurred both the American Revolution and the Fourth Amendment. Citing this history, the Supreme Court has consistently held that suspicionless, warrantless searches and seizures are almost per se unconstitutional. And there are powerful originalist arguments that they should always be per se unconstitutional, including detailed evidence that that was Madison's view. The government argues that bulk phone records collection should instead be judged under the so-called special needs exception to the warrant and suspicion requirements that the Supreme Court invented in the 1980s. But this invented exception only applies when compliance with the core constitutional requirements are impracticable. And experts conclude that the government could practicably comply with them. Indeed, even the Director of National Intelligence recently acknowledged this. So the special needs exception doesn't apply to bulk phone record collection. But even assuming for the sake of argument that it did, bulk collection would still be unconstitutional because even under the special needs exception, the Supreme Court has held that a suspicionless search or seizure is still unconstitutional unless, quote, the privacy interests implicated are minimal and an important government interest would be jeopardized by an individualized suspicion requirement. But the privacy interests that bulk collection implicates are maximal, not minimal, sweeping up billions of records about hundreds of millions of innocent Americans containing the most intimate personal details. Let me quote Princeton University professor Edward Felton, a leading computer expert. As he explained, the metadata in these phone records convey highly sensitive information, which traditionally could be obtained only by viewing the content of the calls. Quote, through this metadata, the government can learn our religion, our work habits, our civic and political affiliations, the rise and fall of our intimate relationships, the diagnosis of a life-threatening disease, the telltale signs of a corporate merger, and the identification of a prospective government whistleblower and an anonymous litigant. Dragnet phone record collections also failed the second prong of the special needs test because experts concur that we can effectively counter terrorism through targeted surveillance. That was the conclusion of both high-level commissions that issued detailed reports on point within the past year, the President's Review Group and the Privacy and Civil Liberties Oversight Board. Likewise, Judge Leon said, the government does not cite a single instance in which the NSA's bulk collection actually aided in achieving any time-sensitive objection. Now, in the lawsuits that the ACLU and others have brought against the NSA bulk program, the government's main defense rests on the so-called third-party doctrine, which is based on some Supreme Court cases that have held that where we voluntarily disclose data to third parties, we forfeit a reasonable expectation of privacy in that data and hence have no Fourth Amendment claim when the third party gives that data to the government. However, the court has never held that the third-party doctrine always bars Fourth Amendment claims, as the government itself recognizes. For instance, even the government recognizes that we do have a reasonable expectation of privacy in the contents of our calls and our emails, even though phone companies also have access to those. The government's third-party argument centers on a 1979 case, Smith versus Maryland, which also involved phone records. But beyond that one single fact, Smith is light years apart from the mass program we're debating. The court held that Michael Smith, a criminal suspect, had no reasonable expectation of privacy in the list of phone numbers that he called during just 2 days, and the government didn't even retain that information. In contrast, the NSA's indiscriminate metadata collection presents the following completely different question: whether hundreds of millions of Americans who are not criminal suspects have a reasonable expectation of privacy in a complete catalog of the phone numbers, date, time, duration, and location of every call we have made or received since 2006 and continuing on indefinitely, all of which the government will retain for at least 5 years. Now, most Americans probably aren't even aware that their phone companies are collecting this detailed information, and we certainly haven't consented to the companies systematically turning it all over to the government in violation of their written privacy policies. As Professor Felton explained, the only way to avoid creating such metadata is to avoid telephone communication altogether. In other words, not a real choice, given the vastly increased importance of such communication in our 21st century world. These key technological changes constitute yet another reason why Smith is materially distinguishable from bulk phone record collection. As Justice Scalia wrote in a 2001 majority opinion about thermal imaging, our Fourth Amendment privacy should not be left to the mercy of advancing technology. And in the court's 2012 GPS case, five justices expressly questioned whether Smith applies to new technology in opinions by Justices Alito and Sotomayor. Likewise, just this past June, the justices unanimously recognized that digital is different, so that prior cases allowing searches and seizures incident to arrest do not apply to cell phones. Ditto for Smith. It simply does not apply to dragnet metadata collection. The government's other major argument in our NSA litigation is that the Fourth Amendment doesn't apply when it vacuums up this massive sensitive data, but rather only when the government examines the data. This is dead wrong for many reasons, starting with, again, the Fourth Amendment's plain language and original meaning. On these points, I'd like to quote a Federalist Society paper, see James Madison there in the corner, by Randy Barnett, whom I saw earlier, Randy, hi, and Jim Harper, titled, Why NSA's Bulk Data Seizures Are Illegal and Unconstitutional. Quote, the founders thought that the seizure of papers or data for later perusal was an abuse distinct from but equivalent to the use of the reviled general warrants. After all, if the government's contrary position prevailed, it could collect any of our data, including the contents of our communications, on the pledge that we should trust government employees not to actually look at it without first getting a warrant. Right. Government employees have such a great track record of respecting and protecting the confidentiality of our data, not to mention the government's own data. Indeed, the FISA court has harshly chided and sanctioned the NSA for repeatedly violating even the modest limits that it had imposed on the bulk phone records program, including specifically by searching these records without the required reasonable suspicion. In conclusion, then, the government's trust us argument flies in the face of the facts as well as the Fourth Amendment. To allow the government to seize first and show probable cause later is exactly the opposite of what the Fourth Amendment requires and exactly the opposite of what it meant to Madison and the other founders. Thank you very much.
I, too, would like to thank both the Federalist Society for putting on this program and also Nadine for being here repeatedly to prove that this organization is interested not only in repeating ideas but in sharing them. I will promise you that I will be both more brief and less spirited. But I think where I ought to start is with a discussion of how this program actually works, how the NSA bulk collection program works and why it's there. The metadata is the calling and the call number, the date, and the duration of the call. That's it. No content, no identity of the caller or the person who has been called, no information about location other than area code. That material is stored so that it can be available to be searched when the NSA gets a number that's reasonably associated with a terrorist person or location. The idea is that the suspect number is then run against the database of stored numbers to see which numbers it has called and which numbers have called it and when. The principal purpose is to have an outward look at whether terrorists are reaching out to people in this country. If that technology had been in place in 2001, the FBI would have known that a man named Khalid al-Midar and another named Nawaf al-Hazmi, two of the 9/11 terrorists who they had been looking for, were in fact in the United States and on the West Coast and had been called by a known safe house in Pakistan. There are only 22 people at NSA who have authority to query that database. By the end of 2012, I think it was, they had done so about 300 times. That process is overseen by what might be described as a Madisonian trifecta. Executive authorities at the upper reaches of the NSA and the rest of the executive, Congress through the two intel committees in the Senate and the House that exercise oversight over NSA, and of course the Foreign Intelligence Surveillance Court, which has authorized the gathering of this information about 35 times. The statutory basis for gathering the information is a law that permits the FBI to subpoena tangible things relevant to national security investigations. Relevance here is determined by the need for a library of information that undoubtedly includes information relating to terrorist activity. As the FISA court put it, because the subset of terrorist communications is ultimately contained within the whole of the metadata produced, but can only be found after the production is aggregated and then queried using identifiers determined to be associated with identified international terrorist organizations, the whole production is relevant to the ongoing investigation of necessity. Obviously, large databases are effective in establishing patterns only to the extent that they're comprehensive. When they're comprehensive, they can reveal the organizational details of social structures like terrorist organizations. Relevance has always been, in all evidentiary contexts, a flexible concept, and particularly where no cognizable Fourth Amendment right of any particular person is compromised by the collection itself. There's every reason to apply a broad standard, since a narrow and precise one is applied precisely at the time when the data is actually searched. It is not permissible to mine the data or to use it for any purpose other than determining whether a known terrorist number has been in contact with or has been contacted by another number. When a query produces information of interest, and that interest pertains to a U.S. person, that information may be disseminated outside the NSA only if it pertains to counterterrorism or is necessary to understand counterterrorism information already in hand or to weigh its importance. That's it. Have there been compliance issues in connection with the program? Yes. The program is administered by human beings and by computers. That's a combination that's bound to produce mistakes. However, they have been self-disclosed by NSA to the FISA court, which has occasionally both criticized and imposed additional restrictions on the gathering of the data until it's assured that whatever problem there was has been solved. Most important, at least to me, is that so far as I know, and so far as there is a record that I can consult, none of the compliance incidents reported to the Foreign Intelligence Surveillance Court has been intentional, and since 2009, none of them has involved application of the reasonably articulable suspicion standard, which is what permits querying the data in the first place. In all of the court findings, the briefings to Congress as a result of Department of Justice reviews and internal NSA oversight, again, there has been no finding of any intentional or bad faith violation under this program. Now, what's the Fourth Amendment interest and what's the Fourth Amendment issue? As has been pointed out, at least before we started, the Fourth Amendment protects persons, houses, papers, and, 18th century word for stuff, effects. because telephone wiretaps could permit the government to invade one's home or one's office or hotel room or whatever from outside and listen in on conversations going in inside without actually entering the property, the Supreme Court in Katz formulated the scope of the protection as going to reasonable expectation of privacy. But as Justice Alito pointed out the other evening, the term reasonable expectation of privacy has a certain circularity about it, and the Supreme Court has already held that a person has no reasonable expectation of privacy in telephone metadata, among other reasons, which is already because it's already in the hands of the telephone company. That's how they generate bills. I would suggest to you that not only is Smith controlling here, but this case is a fortiori from Smith. In Smith, the particular metadata was looked at. In what we're talking about here, the metadata that is gathered is not looked at until it is riffled through and the government's electrons run past all the electrons in the file until they find one that they're interested in. Now, do you seriously think that it violates your privacy or mine or anybody else's to have your electron be one of the bazillion that the government's electrons run past when they're looking for somebody of interest? I don't. And more to the point, I hesitate to channel Madison. I don't think Madison would either. When the metadata is gathered preliminarily to being examined for hits on a particular number, it is not monitored. When it's initially gathered, it's not examined, and all that happens is that a computer search is made for relevant hits on a known number. Analyzing that program for Fourth Amendment purposes based on how it could be misused is very much like analyzing the carrying of weapons by police officers based on the possibility that they could be turned on innocent civilians. Yes, they could, but is that a reason for disarming police? And so far as the government is concerned, I'm going to tell you a deep, dark secret. There ain't no such thing as the U.S. government. They're just a bunch of people. Many of them are dedicated, believe just as strongly as you do in human freedom, and work every day to promote it. By and large, those people work for the NSA. Some of those people are none of the above. Those people work for the IRS. All I'm saying is that when you have an organization using a procedure like the one that I've described, to judge it by the standards of the IRS is a big and potentially tragic mistake. Thank you very much.
That concludes round one of our debate. Round two is a rebuttal or reply of 7 minutes each. So Nadine Strossen.
Well, sad but true, I think the NSA could give the IRS a run for its money. For just a few examples, in 2008, two former NSA analysts told ABC that they and their coworkers had listened in on the personal phone calls of soldiers stationed overseas. "Hey, check this out," one would say he was told. "There's good phone sex," or "there's some pillow talk. Pull up this call." NSA analyst Adrienne Klein told ABC she listened to hundreds of private communications between Americans, including many from the International Red Cross and Doctors Without Borders. NSA whistleblower Russ Tice claims he saw NSA orders to tap the phone of then-Senator, well, you might like this, Senator Barack Obama, Hillary Clinton, Senator John McCain, Colin Powell, David Petraeus, and a current Supreme Court justice. Michael Hayden, who was NSA director when the first domestic spying program began, corroborated claims that he remembered collectors who were fined for snooping on ex-spouses. So we are all human, which is exactly why Madison said, was it Madison or Jefferson, forgive me, one of the founders that, I think it was Madison, if humans were angels, we wouldn't need the restraint of the Fourth Amendment, but precisely because we're not, we do. Thank you very much. There have been a number of points trying to dismiss metadata as not being so revealing, as not only our computer expert has testified, but in a brief by Nobel Prize-winning computer experts from Princeton, MIT, top universities all over the country, agreed that metadata is largely a proxy for content. And let me quote somebody who's got bona fide and national security credentials, Michael Morell, former deputy CIA director, testifying before the Senate Judiciary this January, challenged the whole content metadata dichotomy, saying there is quite a bit of content in metadata. There's not a sharp distinction. It is more of a continuum. The idea that we need this program in order to track suspects is something that has now been backed away from even by the government itself. Interestingly enough, through FOIA requests, we have gotten hold of some of the opinions and briefs that have been submitted to the FISA court. And in 2008, the NSA was claiming that this program was absolutely essential in order for them to protect us against terrorism. Well, now that they are in open court, subject to review and to counter arguments, suddenly the arguments are much more modest. Take a look at the brief that the government itself has filed in the ACLU Second Circuit litigation, in the DC Circuit parallel litigation. To quote the government, the strongest it is saying now about this program is that it is one means, it is one method, it can contribute, it can complement other methods. And again, every independent review that's been taken says that individualized, targeted, traditional means of surveillance would do the job. We're told that the querying is limited. You just have to do the arithmetic, as Judge Leon did in great detail in footnotes in his opinion, because the government takes the data to three hops. In other words, not only every person who was communicated with within a five-year period, but then every person that one communicated with, and I shouldn't say person, I should say number, and every number that one communicated with, we get into the multi-millions. With respect to the minimization procedures, as Michael correctly acknowledges, there have been such severe compliance issues that went way beyond the 2009 ones that he talked about. Even after the strong sanctions that were issued by FISA Judge Reggie Walton in 2009, the government continued to have compliance problems. In October 2011, the FISC presiding judge, John Bates, found that the government had misrepresented the scope of its targeting of internet communications. He said, "The court is troubled that this is the third instance in less than 3 years in which the government has disclosed a substantial misrepresentation regarding the scope of a major collection program." And we are dependent on self-reporting by the NSA. To quote another Federalist Society paper by Jeremy Rapkin, I don't have it at the podium, but it also has the Madison profile in the upper left-hand corner there. Rapkin pointed out that this is only the tip of the iceberg of the compliance problems we know about, because we are dependent on the NSA itself to come clean. With respect to reasonable expectations of privacy, I'm going to again quote the Federalist Society paper by Randy Barnett and Jim Harper, who said, "No distinction should be made between taking a call in a phone booth with the door closed," that was the Katz case that Michael quoted, "sealing a letter, password protecting one's email, or selecting a phone company with a suitable privacy policy. Common experience shows that phone companies keep phone data private from everyone, but the customer and a small circle of service providers that are bound to the phone company's privacy rules. The public therefore reasonably expects these records are kept from government agencies absent a warrant and consents to disclose this information to phone companies on that condition." We are entitled. We factually have reasonable expectations of privacy, as public opinion surveys show. About the public's, the majority of the public does object to this metadata program, and we are entitled to that reasonable expectation. Now, I want to close by saying that this isn't just about phone records, important as they are. Because the argument that is being made is that the government should have the power to engage in bulk collection, and we should be able to trust it not to look at that information until or unless it has probable cause. On that logic, that means the government could collect all manner of private information about us, just promising us, oh, we're not going to look at it. So, Mike, I guess I'd like to ask you, would you really want to have the government put a camera in your bedroom or your bathroom and just say, but don't worry, we're not going to look at it until we get a probable cause warrant? I certainly wouldn't want that. So, this isn't just about phone records. Even much more is at stake, because the logic of Mr. Mukasey's argument and the government argument here is that everything we do that leaves a digital trail, whenever we send an email, visit a website, use a credit card, or even just walk around with our phone turned on, the government would be able to collect that data as a routine matter in bulk. This is the epitome of the dreaded general warrants that propelled the Fourth Amendment, but taken to an extreme that the framers could not have imagined. Let's honor James Madison's plain words and their original meaning. Let's bar indiscriminate collection of phone records and all other metadata. Thank you.
Well, we can agree on one thing, which is let's honor James Madison's original words and original meaning. I think other than that, we agree on very little. The six instances that were referred to of people overhearing, people at NSA overhearing conversations that they shouldn't have overheard, do not relate to this program at all. They relate to a foreign surveillance program that allows us to listen to foreigners overseas, not to Americans. They were listening to Americans. And they were soundly thrashed. They did not involve, and it has never involved, improper analysis of metadata. So far as survey data on what most Americans believe about this program, I think deciding public policy issues based on public misconceptions about what a federal program is about and what it's not about is a bad way to decide public issues, particularly when they relate to national security. I'll go back and say again, as I said before, that the only time this data is analyzed is when there is authorization to search for a particular number identified with a terrorist location or a terrorist himself, and only to find out whether it is communicated with or been communicated with by a number in the United States. To say that, therefore, all of that data is being analyzed all the time is simply a distortion. And there's no other word, there's really no other word to describe it. So far as Federalist Society papers and general principles of privacy, I would suggest to you that we look at Madison's words and at and what they actually protect, rather than at overarching broad statements. The overarching broad statements are fine, but they become, as I believe Ronald Rotunda once wrote, like the smile on the Cheshire cat. You know, eventually the cat, which is the Fourth Amendment, disappears, and all that's left is the grin. The program that NSA has been useful. It has helped in investigations. The notion that it hasn't stopped the chambering of a round, I think, is ridiculous. If you judge any intelligence program on that basis, no intelligence program has been successful. But intelligence gathering is an incremental process. This is part of it. And we scrap it again at our risk. Thank you very much.
So that concludes round two of our debate. And so our next phase is a more informal give and take. And so I'd start by asking the debaters, did you hear anything that you'd like to respond to? Would you like to take a minute to respond to the last
Yes, if I may.
Sure.
Michael, I didn't respond to your earlier points about the querying of the metadata, because I understood we were going to be focusing on collection. But the way the querying works is that the entire database has to be analyzed, right? You take the so-called seed number for which matches are being sought, and you have to run that across the entire database. Then for every number that is a hit, it then generates its own search, as I mentioned, the second hop and the so-called third hop. And every hit then goes into something that's called the corporate store. And every number in there can be searched without any constraints, without any of the minimization procedures. So make no mistake about it. I believe that the collection alone does violate the Fourth Amendment, but it is going beyond collection. It is, in fact, analyzing all of our metadata regularly.
I would say that on the first search is not an analysis any more than you're looking out over this audience as an analysis to find a face that you recognize. If you believe that that's an analysis, then I guess we're simply talking about different things. The first search is simply a rapid run through of all the numbers in the file, all the telephone calls made in the country, in order to find one that matches the number that you have. The ones that don't match are, I guess, in a metaphysical sense, searched. But I don't think that the Fourth Amendment is about metaphysics.
But the Fourth Amendment is about seizures as well as searches. And that's, to me, a very powerful textual argument that the, quote, mere collection of information by the government is itself a violation of the Fourth Amendment unless it complies with the individualized suspicion and warrant requirement.
The seizure is not from the person whose telephone it is. The seizure, in quotes, is from the company that has it anyway.
But that goes,
and uses it to prepare a bill.
Okay, but so that goes back to this so-called third-party doctrine, and again, the implications of your position, which is the government's position, to me are extremely sobering. If in fact it is true that any information that we necessarily, in this case, turn over, because that is a prerequisite for having telephone service, for having internet service, for having all kinds of financial, even medical services, we have to share data with doctors, with hospitals, with banks, you name it, that we're turning over that information, making it available to them for a limited purpose. They give us contracts and promises that they're going to be protecting our privacy, and yet you and the government are saying that we are forfeiting all Fourth Amendment rights to that data whatsoever. Now, if that's true, that means that we don't even need these minimization procedures that you and the government have been touting, because you're saying the Fourth Amendment wouldn't apply at all.
That's not at all what I'm saying. And in particular, people in these debates often resort to the medical records example. Mm-hmm. Medical records, in every meaningful sense, belong to the patient. They may be in the hands of the hospital, but they are hemmed around with privilege protections and all kinds of other protections that have absolutely nothing to do with the kind of stuff we're talking about here, which again is billing information.
Under the federal telephone statute, I've got it in my papers, if anybody's interested in a citation, that metadata information also belongs to the customer and not to the telephone company.
Not the metadata, the data that you put out to apply for a telephone, yes, but that's not what's being searched for.
So just to clarify our Fourth Amendment question, are you taking the position that the collection of these records are not searches and seizures at all, or that they are reasonable searches and seizures?
I'm taking the position that they're not searches and seizures at all.
Right, which, as I say, leads to the astonishing conclusion that the government could do whatever it wanted. It could read every single one of the records. It could analyze every single one of them. It could use them for any purposes whatsoever, including law enforcement purposes, way beyond counterterrorism. It could turn them over to other government agencies, including the IRS, not popular in this crowd, or for that matter, to any other. Because if the Fourth Amendment isn't, you know, if the Fourth Amendment doesn't apply, then the so-called minimization procedures are just a matter of legislative and executive grace, not constitutionally mandated. I mean, it's the consequences are sweeping, to say the least.
Would you agree with that? Can the
no?
And if that,
are those procedural protections a matter of grace?
They're not a matter of grace. This is the way the program was constructed.
Yeah.
They prevent this from devolving into what would be an unconstitutional search if they were to draw, for example, a portrait of my telephone records and a portrait of all the people I call and who call me, simply in order for having, not because I've been called by a terrorist, but simply in order to investigate me and my life.
The Telecommunications Act, to return to that earlier point, the Telecommunications Act defines telephone numbers dialed, information contained in phone bills, and other information relating to the quantity, technical configuration, type, destination, location, and amount of use of a telecommunications service, all of the metadata, as, quote, customer proprietary network information. And that statute prohibits phone companies from disclosing or using it in statutorily unapproved ways. So even if you take a property rights-based approach to the Fourth Amendment, which I'm sure my friend Roger would love to do, Cato Institute, the U.S. law pretty clearly defines that as customer information as to which we have a property interest as well as a reasonable expectation of privacy.
It bars the phone company. It doesn't bar the government.
Well, the Fourth Amendment bars the government and the phone company.
That's what we're here to decide, isn't
yeah.
it?
Our debaters seem to agree that...
I'm in suspense. What could possibly...
seem to agree at least that the Supreme Court case of Smith v. Maryland is relevant here. Nadine, you've said this is clearly a distinguishable case. Judge, you've said this is a fortiori from Smith v. Maryland. I wonder if either one of you would want to say a bit more about that.
Oh, I think I've said quite a lot about it. Judge Leon in the district court decision here in D.C.
Could you take a moment and remind us of the case?
Yes. This was a challenge that was brought by a privacy activist named Mr. Clayman, immediately challenging the metadata program after Edward Snowden's revelations. It was brought about the same time that the ACLU began a parallel lawsuit. And interestingly enough, the judge in the ACLU case made a mistake and rejected our constitutional challenge, which is now on appeal in the Second Circuit. It was argued in September. The DC case, which was correctly decided by Judge Leon, was recently argued in the DC Circuit Court of Appeals. But they're basically the same arguments are being made by the governor and the challengers in both cases. It's very clear that the judge in our case was relying on the argument that Michael Mukasey made that the records belong to the phone company. I disagree with that, as I explained. In the DC, and the judge, interestingly enough, the judge in the New York case, Southern District of New York case, said that the collection is breathtaking in scope. That was the judge's words, but he felt that he was constrained by Smith, that it would be only up to the Supreme Court itself to distinguish Smith. In contradistinction to that, Judge Leon here listed about 15 different reasons for the distinctions, many of which I recited in my opening remarks. But in particular, I think what was interesting was he said, we all have an expectation that the phone company would occasionally respond to a police request for a particular call records, as happened in the Smith case, where it was only for less than 2 days, for a person with respect to whom there was individualized suspicion that he had committed a crime. What Judge Leon said is completely different, among many other things, is an ongoing joint intelligence operation where our phone company is pairing up with the government systematically every day to turn over all of that information, contrary to its contractual representations of privacy to us.
So on the one hand, this formally looks quite a bit like Smith v. Maryland, but on the other hand, this is orders of magnitude different in scale. Does that matter?
It would matter if the data that was turned over was being analyzed. It isn't. It's being stored. And there is a vast difference between those two things. If it were being analyzed, of course there'd be a difference.
Could I responded to that already, but I wanted to, for those who are interested in the original meaning of the Fourth Amendment, because let me just commend to your attention a wonderful article in the Michigan Law Review by Thomas Davies called Recovering the Original Fourth Amendment. He goes into enormous detail about those who think that the reasonableness requirement in the Fourth Amendment is that this free-floating balancing test, independent of the warrant and individualized suspicion requirements, are ignoring the history here. The historic meaning of unreasonable was specifically that any general warrant, any general search was inherently unreasonable. It was a term that was derived from Sir Edward Coke, great common law judge, use of the term against reason as a synonym for inherent illegality or inherent unconstitutionality. So unreasonable searches and seizures was a label that denoted the inherent illegality of intrusions made under general warrants. And this blanket warrant from the FISA court to sweep up all of our metadata every day is the epitome of an inherently unreasonable general warrant.
Would you like to respond to that?
Yeah, I mean, I'm interested in what the difference is between this and, for example, compelling the companies to store the information so it can be accessed by the government.
I certainly would have objections to that as well. I think it's less offensive than the government storing it, but
it's marginally.
It's less offensive,
I think, because it's more difficult for the government. And I think that's
as it should be.
Yeah, I think that's perverse.
Well, the Fourth Amendment was put there as a check on the government, and interestingly enough, in the cell phones case that the Supreme Court decided unanimously this summer, how often does the court do that? The court recognized that, and by the way, the holding there was that as a search incident to an arrest, where the court has a lot of precedents that say the arresting officer therefore does not need a warrant or probable cause to seize possessions that are on the arrestee's person, the court unanimously said we're not bound by those old precedents with respect to cell phones because the difference in quantity of information revealed is in fact a difference in kind. So I think this is a very powerful precedent for this case.
It was the content, though, of the phone that was being searched.
But the point,
all the apps, right. All the records, not only the record of telephone calls, but address books, the whole nine yards.
I agree with that, but the reason why I raised that case and I got excited, so I said more about it. But the reason why I raised that is the court unanimously said, look, we recognize that it would be really convenient for police officers if they could seize those phones without a warrant and probable cause. But the Fourth Amendment is not about making law enforcement easier. And it did say this, and these are the exact words, privacy comes at a cost. Now, to be sure, the cost is not damage to counterterrorism in this situation, as every single expert has said. Interestingly enough, most recently, both the president and the attorney general and the director of national intelligence submitted a letter to the Senate about the pending USA Freedom Act, which would reinstate an individualized suspicion requirement before collecting metadata. And they said this would not adversely impact our counterterrorism operations.
Actually, what they said was they were comfortable with the statute. And then they said that it might have some additional impacts after it is enacted. If that sounds suspiciously to your ear, as it does to mine, like we have to pass the bill in order to find out what's in it, that's what's in the letter. And I would suggest to you what that means is that additional impacts could include things like holes in the ground where buildings used to stand, and empty chairs where people used to sit. And that's a very bad price to pay.
Well,
I'm afraid I have to call a pause for a moment. We're going to try to invite the audience into the discussion if we can. I think we have mics that can move around the room if you show your hand. And I would just remind you, please, we're looking for questions. So what a question sounds like is there's an inflection to your voice. It ends with a question mark. You really shouldn't need more than two declarative sentences.
As a former district judge, I will tell you, it's not a long statement followed by, isn't that true?
And as a free speech advocate, I defend your right to make statements.
I think we have one here.
My name is Howard Klein from Orange County, California. I want to thank both the panelists for a really riveting discussion, and I appreciate that. That's my statement. The other statement I'll make is that I think that so far, in my mind, this is a tie. And I want to ask what I think might be the tie-breaking question. Suppose Judge Leon's decision becomes the law of the land. And suppose at some point thereafter the NSA or some other authority finds the phone number and the location of a known terrorist or terrorist headquarters. What would then be a constitutional response to locate that person's contacts within the U.S.?
That question was actually answered by Edward Felton, the ACLU's expert in our litigation, in a supplemental affidavit he submitted in the Second Circuit, because the government raised that question in its opening brief. And he explained how it could be virtually instantaneous if the government didn't have the whole haystack of information already, by simply submitting that phone number to the major telecommunications companies and asking them, so there would be individualized suspicion to search their database to see if there were any numbers that were in contact with that suspect number. That algorithms, he explained, could be constructed to do that virtually instantaneously. And that, by the way, was the point in Judge Leon's ruling. The government is not even arguing that this is the only way that number can be used to look for matches in the United States. It was just arguing that it could be done more quickly if it has the whole database. And our expert has said, no, it would be just as quickly through individualized suspicion.
Did you want to speak to that?
Should we briefly? First off, I don't think it could be done just as quickly. The telephone companies store things, different telephone companies store things in varied ways. But the only thing that guarantees that telephone companies, in fact, store the information at all, and they store it for only 18 months right now, is an FCC regulation to that effect. I can easily foresee a telephone company advertising, use our service. We destroy our records quickly. And I can also imagine the FCC changing its regulation. So we are dependent on a very fragile rule and a lack of uniformity among telephone companies.
John.
Oh, sorry, yes, go ahead.
John Eastman. As an original meeting, the general warrant concern was about criminal investigations. And we're talking about here intelligence gathering in time of war. I'm mindful of a story of my grandfather as an ambulance driver in France, and his letters back home were full of the censors cut and paste, almost like doll letters, because they were concerned about revealing information if that bag of mail got distributed, picked up by the enemy. There was no warrant, never even considered a warrant before they did that. And that's 1917, but it's consistent with the investigation of Major Andre, all these other things at the time of the founding. There was a big difference between criminal and intelligence gathering in war. Should we take that line as being more significant than, I think, Nadine, your commentary, which is more focused on criminal law?
Interestingly enough, that's not an argument that the government has made here. I think because of the, what we're talking about is the bulk collection of Americans' records, right? I'm sorry, he just keeps being relevant. James Madison had that famous statement about, you know, I'm gonna paraphrase this one, that the first excuse for violating the constitutional rights of Americans is gonna be some overseas conflict. This, in the Fourth Amendment, does not contain an exception for foreign intelligence when certainly the framers could have put in that kind of an exception.
A couple of points. I think that the general warrant is not a proper analogy here at all, simply because, again, the general warrant involves a search of particular records. So, for example, in colonial days, the British would show up at a warehouse where colonists stored their stuff and would go through the stuff. They did not limit themselves, for example, to asking the warehouse owner for a list of people who stored stuff in the warehouse, which is a closer analogy to this. I also take the gentleman's point about there being a difference between intelligence gathering and gathering of evidence for criminal investigation.
Well, in the most relevant Supreme Court decision on that point was United States versus United States District Court, the so-called Keith case. That was for domestic intelligence gathering, and the government argued that, maybe that's different, but the government said there's this big distinction between intelligence gathering and criminal law enforcement, and the Supreme Court rejected it and said, no, you still need to have a warrant and probable cause. I also think of the opinion by that odd duo of Antonin Scalia and John Paul Stevens in the Hamdi case, where they pointed out that the only exception in the Constitution to any individual right in times of war or rebellion is, of course, the suspension of the privilege of the writ of habeas corpus, and very strongly arguing that, therefore, there is an intent that, whether we're talking about counterterrorism or war or foreign intelligence, that these are still the governing standards.
Professor Soman.
Ilya Soman, George Mason University. If I understand General Mukasey correctly, you said that if this data was being analyzed, then the collection would be a Fourth Amendment violation, but since it's just gathered but not analyzed until various additional safeguards are observed, it's not. I guess I do have some qualms about that it might be a seizure even if it's not analyzed, but even assuming the premise to be true, can we really believe that in the face of this vast treasure trove of data on millions upon millions of people, the NSA and other government agencies that might get it from the NSA will exercise superhuman restraint of a kind that they don't seem to be capable of in virtually any other context and not use this data despite the vast temptations to do so for all sorts of purposes?
The circumstances under which this data is held, you say share it with other government agencies? There is no other government agency that they're allowed to share it with unless they get a hit, and then only in limited cases. And the circumstances under which this information is kept, do I believe that it's going to be kept by the NSA? Yes.
If there were evidence to the contrary, would that change your view?
Hell yes.
It would change your view on the constitutional question.
It would change my view. I don't know about changing my view on the constitutional question. It would change my view. But I mean, it's some, we have a set of rules in the Constitution. Absolutely none of them determines its own application. That was taught to us in the 19th century. And as far as I know, there is no rule that determines its own application. It's all determined by people. Either you trust them or you don't.
Roger Pilon.
And again, you've got the oversight by a constitutional a Madisonian trifecta.
I'm Roger Pilon with the Cato Institute, and I'm here speaking for myself, not for the institute that pays my salary, at least has done so up until now. Nadine, since you invoked my name, I'm going to have to put my question to you. Seems to me that right at the end of your formal exchange, the issues were joined when Nadine said that she would require a warrant for any intrusion. And Michael said that's like asking us to find out what's in the bill after it's passed. The problem you're up against, Nadine, was posed by Richard Posner, of all people, when he said that the problem you're facing with terrorism and with the intelligence pertaining to it is that we don't know who the terrorists are. And so we have to have some minimally intrusive surveillance in order to answer that question. It is like looking for a needle in a haystack, he said. In other words, you have to have the haystack in order to find the needle. If you know where the terrorists are so that you can then go in and get the warrant, all power to you. But I dare say that no one knows that.
Well, as many counterterrorism experts have said, you don't make it easier to find a needle in the haystack by adding more hay to the stack. And in fact, studies that have been done, starting with the bipartisan post 9/11 commission that looked at the actual causes of the 9/11 disaster, not a single one has concluded that the problem was lack of information. To the contrary, they say we're drowning in data that we do not have enough time to analyze. And I think the brilliance of the Fourth Amendment is, I think most people focus on the extent to which it protects individual liberty by forbidding the government to proceed on stereotypes, guilt by association. But it also works to channel government resources efficiently and effectively. It makes more sense to channel surveillance where there is individualized suspicion. And again, DNI Clapper himself recently said that we may well not need that whole haystack. He repudiated the whole metaphor.
I believe we have time for one more audience question right here.
Harry Lewis, a hypothetical question. A bomb explodes at the finish of the Boston Marathon. There's an ensuing frantic police search, house to house, for the terrorists, and citizens' homes are being broken into without their consent, without warrants, in a search for the terrorists. To the two speakers, did that violate the Fourth Amendment to the U.S. Constitution under those circumstances? And to what extent is emergency or urgency an appropriate consideration in the policy being made in this area?
Well, there's a case on that, dealing with somebody who held up a supermarket and tossed a gun away somewhere in the supermarket, and
exigent
circumstances exception was invoked to permit him to be questioned without warnings, asking him, where's the gun? Because of the fear that it would fall into the hands of a child or some other customer. That's, I think, not a difficult case.
Yeah. The exigence, I wanted to point this out anyway, as the ACLU has in our briefs and our lawsuit on the NSA program, nobody questions the so-called exigent circumstances exception, which is different from the one that the government is invoking here. So the exigent circumstances would be literally you have an emergency, an opportunity to protect a life, for example, that the time to get a warrant is going to prevent you from doing that. The government is not arguing that that exception justifies this program, interestingly enough. They are relying, so they're not even making that claim. They're relying instead on this so-called special needs exception above and beyond the usual law enforcement need. And further, to your point, Roger, maybe you think the Supreme Court should make that judge-invented exception even broader than it is, but that exception itself demands individualized suspicion unless you can show that it's impracticable and that the intrusion on privacy is minimal.
Would you like a final word?
No.
Great. These two could go at it all day, but we have to stop.
Thank you very much. I'll shake this hand.
Yeah, of course.